Welcome to Catholic Answers Live. It's Friday and we got a great show for you today. We're going to do our Friday panel show about kind of a Catholic take on the news of the world. Unfortunately, it's very, very slow news time, so we probably won't have much to talk about, but maybe some reminiscences of, I don't know, medieval Catholicism or something. We'll come up with something because it's such a slow news time.
When quickening is.
We probably will talk about that. Chris Check, our president, here with us. Thank you, Chris, for being on the panel.
I'm glad to be here.
Also, Joe Heschmeyer, apologist extraordinaire, the world's best Catholic apologist who consistently wears flannel. Hi, Joe.
I like that asterisk.
Yeah.
Little check next to my name.
I thought you were going to say who's in Kansas City.
Actually, there's some tough competition. There's some good apologists in Kansas City.
Yeah. Well, Chris came up with the idea that we should all wear flannel because you're kind of a flannel guy. So now we all have flannel on. This is the second time we've done this. And then that's a brilliant idea that Chris came up with. Chris should get all the credit for that.
I thought it was brilliant.
Yes.
And funny.
Yes. And then Edgar made this small, tiny little contribution where he said, call it the flannel panel. So from now on, this will be called the flannel panel.
Edgar has...
Meanwhile, I'm just amused that we have an entirely visual gag.
Yeah, for radio. An entirely visual gag. That is so funny. Yeah. First of all, before we get into the panel, and we got so much to talk about, of course, the Roe versus Wade thing. We've got some... maybe we'll talk about the war. That's a good one. We got the HHS secretary making some kind of scary comments about the transgender care for folks who identify as transgender or however you're supposed to say it. Elon Musk bought Twitter. We got a lot of stuff to talk about from a Catholic perspective. But before we do that, I really want to take a minute to say thank you because people were extremely generous with us over the last 3 days, and I mean extremely generous, so that it's possible when we have added everything up that this was the best 3 days of radio fundraising in the history of Catholic Answers. We definitely met all of our matches. We right now we're several thousand dollars over even what we, you know, we needed $220,000. We're up to almost $230,000 now, but there's still money to come in. So it's probably our best pledge drive ever. And I just wanted to say thank you. And I know Chris Check wanted to say thank you.
I want to thank a lot of people. I want to thank the staff here at Catholic Answers. When we do our pledge drives, all the staff is on the phones, and it's a lot of fun. We have a great time, and Erica goes around with the sweet trolley or whatever.
Sweet trolley, yes. A tray of bribes to keep working. Yes. Here you go. Here's some cookies.
I like the little Nutter Butter. Cookies, the bite-sized Nutter Butters.
I regret them later. My stomach is like, why did you eat Nutter Butters?
But I'm super grateful to everyone who donated, and I want to say especially thank you to everybody who became a monthly giver. We had more people becoming monthly givers or increasing their monthly support on this drive than ever before. So I want to thank those monthly givers. To celebrate, I wore under my flannel.
Oh, you got your Society 315 shirt on.
315 shirt.
Wow.
So CA Society 315, at any time you want to become a monthly giver.
So Joe.
And then, of course, there is this wonderful gentleman from St. Louis.
I'm holding the Budweiser in my hands. I've only got a six-pack so far, but I'm going to get a whole case so that all the staff can have a Budweiser because Tim Staples was unashamedly begging for someone to give us $10,000. He utterly without shame, and which we have to do. I mean, to ask money to do the work of spreading the good news, I think you have to be without shame. We beg for money. That's what we do, and I don't feel any shame about it at all. But somehow, even having no shame at all, I have slightly more shame than Tim Staples has. I don't know how that happened. So a gentleman who works for Anheuser-Busch,
Ted.
Gave us the $10,000 during the second to last
hour. He sent a message, said, I felt sufficiently browbeaten by Tim Staples, and he's been asking for that 10 grand, I finally decided to do it. He beat me into submission.
So I got,
I knew it was that easy to get $10,000 for people, I would just start approaching strangers and be like, can I please have $10,000?
I'm paraphrasing. Thank you, Ted. And Ted, by the way, put that 10 grand up as a challenge.
Yeah, God bless
so
you.
That inspired other people to give.
So just thank you. We'll have some numbers next week. We'll know where we are more, but it was You know, and it's extremely meaningful to us. You can just feel it in the building how good everybody feels. It's very affirming of our work. And then we really promise you every dollar of that is going to turn around and go into a media ministry that is completely devoted to defending Jesus Christ and his church in a modern world that, as we will talk about momentarily,
Can I set you up for that? By the way, we received a call yesterday from a woman in Los Angeles who gave us $77 in honor of her 77th birthday.
I saw that.
She spoke to Dave Matheson, our development director extraordinaire, and she told the story that she survived an abortion 77 years ago when she was in Puerto Rico. And as she understands it, Planned Parenthood was in Puerto Rico experimenting with saline abortions. And the nurse present took her three pounds and injected some adrenaline into her heart, to revive her, and then brought her back to revived her, hid her in a shoebox, covered her with cotton, and took her to be adopted. And now this woman lives with, she's 77 years old and has had four children and tons of grandchildren.
Praise God for that.
And she wanted to say thank you to Catholic Answers for all the good pro-life work we've done and celebrate her 77th birthday, which almost never happened. For the courage of this nurse. I mean, I want to meet this nurse.
To heaven then, because I bet that's where she is now.
I'm working on that, by the way, Si.
Yeah, I know you're working on it. And Jesus is working on it, too. That's the more important part.
He's working
part,
a lot harder than I.
But that's what a great story. I'm sure that the mainstream media will want to pick that up. That's something that, don't you think CNN will want to cover? Because in their fair reporting, they want to cover both sides, both the woman and the child, right?
Balanced and fair.
I think we should ask CNN if they're interested in that fantastic human interest story.
Get Edgar to call them up.
I'll give out the number because we can take some calls if people want to talk with us about stuff. Yeah, we'll.
I thought you meant the number for CNN for a second. I was like, let me give out the number.
The number for CNN, the abortion hotline at CNN, 666-6666. Was that a bad joke? Was that wrong? I shouldn't.
It was a good joke, not the right number of it worked for the sake of
it. I got carried away. Edgar's going to take your calls if you want to get in and talk with us. We're not really doing questions today. We're just doing conversation. So if you wanted to get in the conversation, 888-318-7884. And we'll see. We'll see, because it's hard to stop Joe and Chris from talking. So if I can get a word in edgewise, I'll try to get you on with them. 888-318-7884. But the number one story for this week's flannel panel discussion, of course, is Monday night shocking news. In two respects, shocking, but a leak of a first draft of the Supreme Court decision in the Dobbs case in Mississippi, in which it seems clear that the Supreme Court had decided at that time, we don't know now where they are, but they had decided in February to not just to uphold Mississippi's ban of abortion after 15 weeks, but to completely restore the proper constitutional order and contribute, I think, somewhat to the moral order, although that's probably not their concern, by throwing out Roe versus Wade and Casey and saying, look, let's be honest about this. None of this is in the Constitution. And so it was just wonderful news. Either of you want to start off?
I'll say two things.
Okay.
I have many more to say, but Joe's going to have some real good insights. The court was the last thing that people had reverence for, last political institution that people had reverence for, or structure of government, or at least pretended to have reverence for, right? We sort of made a show of having reverence for it. Apparently no longer, because not only has this leak taken place, but there has been no condemnation anyway that I've heard, on the left anyway, for this leak, which, by the
even
way,
the President of the United States has not condemned it.
Now the Chief Justice did, and he should have.
Well, yes, he should. Right.
Yeah, but I haven't seen condemnation at in CNN or the Times or the liberal media or from the political left. So all of that talk about how we're not politicizing the court, that's the one thing we don't that's utter nonsense, and now we know. And actually, the politicization has been going on for a very long time, but now it's out in the open. So
certainly since a switch in time saved nine.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you say, Joe, that it's been the sense of politicization has been very high since the second Roosevelt administration?
I would mark the real sharp increase. Well, I think first was the Warren Court in terms of the court itself being political.
Okay.
And then I think in terms of the relationships between Senate and the court being political, you get a sharp increase with Bork. Before that, you actually get pretty widespread bipartisan support for good judicial nominees, liberal and conservative alike, that if they're qualified, people will vote for them. But as abortion becomes more central, that actually drives the politicization. In other words, like what I'm saying is, like,
exactly,
as the court like arrogates more stuff to itself, then the Senate becomes in no small part a proxy vote for the Supreme Court, and the president becomes a proxy vote for the Supreme Court because he can nominate people.
Because you can't vote for the Supreme Court.
It's just wild. Yeah.
Well, I was thinking about it the other day that all of these battles since Judge Bork was rejected, virtually every battle would not have happened on each particular justice. And there weren't always battles. You know, Ruth Bader Ginsburg sailed through easily. But Justice Thomas and the latest with Justice Kavanaugh, they all had to do with abortion. Had there not been abortion hanging out there like a sword of Damocles over the whole thing, we wouldn't have had these horrible controversies. We might have had, you know, people didn't like them, but it probably would have been a 60-40 vote or a 70-30 vote or something like that.
And in fact, barring something, I can't even imagine what it would be in the political history of the United States. Every nomination hearing going forward is going to be on this question, whether this can we overturn it again? And it will be a perpetual back and forth. In fact, I think that's something that the pro-life movement needs to be alert to.
When we come back,
I was just going to say the second thing here.
I apologize. Yeah.
No, that's fine. The second thing is, this is a Catholic victory. I hope I'm not sounding arrogant or crowing or anything like that here. The pro-life movement in its origin and in large part in its operation has been a Catholic phenomenon. Thanks be to God, in the 80s and at some point there with C. Everett Koop, for example, Harold O.J. Brown, a former colleague of mine from the Rockford Institute, there were some early Lutheran and evangelical pastors who got involved. But the thing in its beginning and largely in its operation was a Catholic thing. And it will be very interesting to see this weekend how many Catholic clergy proudly proclaim that, and with good reason, from the pulpit. The church's faithfulness here, it seems to me, has been rewarded.
When we come back, I want to give you just a little bit of evidence of that, but I also want to ask both of you to consider this question. Why, on such an issue that was so central to a certain political segment of the population, a very pro-abortion segment, that they had the media on their side, they had the universities on their side, they had the major institutions of the country on their side for 50 years, and they did not prevail. Why a loss for them? It should have just been settled, you know, 30 years ago, at least with Casey or something. Why did they lose? I want to talk about that when we come back. But I want to give a little evidence about this Catholic thing that you're talking about. I think it's without question. I think you're right about it. But we'll take a quick break and be right back.
Catch Catholic Answers live anytime at Catholic.com.
Underwriting support provided by Homeschool Connections. Homeschool Connections hosts the Catholic Homeschool Conference. The 2022 Catholic Homeschool Conference is June 10th through 11th, and the website is CatholicHomeschoolConference.com. That's CatholicHomeschoolConference.com.
Underwriting by Great Catholic Music.
Great Catholic Music, your one-of-a-kind streaming platform for traditional Catholic hymns and contemporary favorites 24 hours a day. Music that soothes the soul, that's safe for the whole family to listen to. What a relief. Great Catholic Music. Download the free mobile app or listen on any Alexa-enabled device, or write from your PC or tablet at greatcatholicmusic.com. Great Catholic Music, melodies for the soul.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious mystic monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All mystic monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase mystic monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
EWTN offers listeners and viewers the daily readings to enable you to accompany the Mass of the day. Our Catholic daily readings include the readings of the day, along with online videos. It's a great resource for all who desire to live a life of faith that is pleasing to our Lord. Visit EWTN.com and click Catholicism. EWTN, the Global Catholic Network.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host, joined in studio by our president, Chris Check, president of Catholic Answers, and via the internet with Joe Heschmeyer, apologist extraordinaire and author of some wonderful books, including his most recent and very popular book, The Early Church Was the Catholic Church. Sometimes we get together on Fridays in what we now call the flannel panel, and we talk about the news from a Catholic perspective, and there is enormous Catholic perspective needed on some of these stories. I think one that we'll get to a little later in the program, even more than this Roe versus Wade story. I mean that. I think there's a story out there that needs the Catholic perspective even more than this one at the moment. But I want to tell you about something before I respond to what Chris said about this is essentially a story about the Catholic Church. The pro-life story is a story about the Catholic Church. The flannel panel. We're not playing around with this.
The flannel panel is going to become an interesting thing in August here in East County, San Diego.
Well, let me tell you something right now. Darren decided that we would have a survey of those who are watching the show to decide who is wearing the best flannel shirt. That's right. You can go to SurveyMonkey and vote right now. Darren, how do they do it? They go to Facebook or YouTube? Facebook or YouTube video feed right now, just click on it and vote for your favorite bit of flannel. And then as the show progresses, I'll let you know.
I'm going to kill you guys.
Oh, I don't think so. I think Edgar got me this shirt today. I can explain that later why Edgar had to get me a shirt.
Joe compared my shirt last time to Freddy Krueger. I thought that was very insensitive.
I think it's the Brawny Towel Man. I think you're, yeah. You look like the Brawny Towel Man. The number is 888-318-7884 if you want to get in on the conversation. We're talking about this Roe v. Wade stuff. And I want to just tell you a little thing that, Roe v. Wade was decided on the same day that President Lyndon Johnson died. And so the next day on the cover of the New York Times, the top headline is not Roe v. Wade. The top headline is that President Johnson had died. And then at the nation was in mourning. That's when we used to say those kind of things about presidents. The nation is in mourning. But we probably wouldn't say that about presidents anymore. But then there were two stories about Roe versus Wade. One was the basic rundown of what's in the decision and a kind of a celebratory piece on how powerful this decision was. And then next to that was a story on how Cardinal Cook and Cardinal Kroll were reacting to the news. So what my point is, from day one,
Cardinal Kroll, Philadelphia.
Cardinal Cook in New York City. Yeah. From day one, the New York Times knew what everybody knew. The number one opponent of abortion in the world and certainly in the United States was the Catholic Church. Mm-hmm. And so the thing that you did when you reported on Roe versus Wade was you told the story of Roe versus Wade and then you turned and you looked at what do the Catholics have to say about this. And Kroll and Cook were very good. Their responses were right on, and they would be consistent with things that we would hear over the course of the next 50 years. But I just wanted to say that because your comment that this is a Catholic story, I think, is right on. This is a Catholic story, but it's a story also of, it's a story of the Catholic Church opening up to cooperate with other people in a way that I think has been good for us. I think Jesus wanted that.
I think it's brought a lot of people into the Catholic Church.
It's brought a lot of people
into
the Catholic Church.
A lot of those evangelicals.
But it's also brought us close to Baptists in a way and to Methodists in a way and to Lutherans and to, I can't name, I'm sorry, Protestantism, I can't name them all, but
Can I just suggest also that in some ways the Catholic Church has saved Protestantism from her own excesses? What I mean here, wow. In 1971, the Southern Baptist Convention passed a resolution saying that abortion should be legal. The Southern Baptists.
Yep, right.
And so it's really shocking when you actually trace the history of this. There were a lot of pretty prominent Protestant voices that said, you know, this is an individual conscience issue, or abortion should be legal, and the role of the church should be to support the mother and her choices. And it was the church which doesn't give in to the times that really stood up to this. Yeah. And, you know, just like with contraception 40 years earlier, Protestantism, both for better and for worse, is much more adaptive to modern society. And I say for better and for worse because there are all sorts of issues where it's like their websites are better, they're more likely to, you know, really tap into the latest trends and crazes and all that. But then it's also for worse because they come under the zeitgeist much more easily. And the church, which, you know, famously thinks in centuries and not in years, doesn't really go in for all of that. I mean, you go look at the Vatican's website, and that's probably what it looked like in 1950.
I don't think they had a website in 1950.
It's hard to say. But numbers, if they did.
Yeah, 888-318-7884 if you want to get involved. But it is a victory. And I asked if you would consider, why do you think this coalition I would like to say one other thing, and I apologize to all the good Catholic bishops out there about whom this is not true, but and Cardinal Kroll and Cardinal Cook, great and all that. But the primary people who forwarded the pro-life movement were the laity
of course.
In the Catholic Church.
Yes.
And often, to the embarrassment of their bishops, they had to work against their bishops. And I'm sorry that that's the history of it. I wish that that was not the case. I wish I could say every Catholic bishop was a beautiful example of a pro-life. And there were great ones. There were great Catholic bishops. But primarily, it was those annoying lay Catholics who wouldn't let it rest, who promoted this and forwarded it, until I think Evangelium Vitae and John Paul II coining the phrase "the culture of life."
Yes,
and then I think it became much more solidified after that. But go ahead.
Your observation there, Cy, points to something coming, and that will be in particular: how will we see the episcopacy in those states, such as our own here in California, for example, or New York or Illinois, which are going to become the abortion tourism sites? How are we going to see, back to the states, not the national issue technically that it once was, how will we see the episcopacies in those various states respond? Are they going to step up? It's a good question.
I think, you know, another thing just to add to that, the idea that the laity are kind of leading the charge strikes me as entirely appropriate in one sense. Like, Vatican II lays out the special role of the laity, and it's to live in the world and to be a light of the gospel in the world and in ordinary society. And it seems like on an issue like this, that on the one hand involves like areas of often nuanced law, and on the other hand is such a sensitive issue in terms of women and men, having men who aren't living in the world as like the spokesman for it was never the most effective kind of presentation. Take someone like Lila Rose, a woman living in the world. She's going to have a certain cachet that even a very good bishop, like let's say my own bishop, Archbishop Naumann, there are people who just will not listen to what a guy in a mitre has to say, no matter how good his arguments are, because they're already shut down.
Earlier, and before the show, Si and I were making the point about how popular our own Trent Horn is with young people, with college students, with high school students. He's
really
a perfect example.
Trent.
So am I.
I feel really proud of Trent.
Yeah. Trent should be very proud of himself right now.
He's probably watching cartoons or something.
Yeah, or X-Men, what is it junk he watches?
I don't know. But he's this great pro-life voice. And then the pro-life stuff is over and he plays with his action figures. Yeah. the number is 888.
You know, these days you can have X-Men and Y women, and it's crazy.
Right. Oh, can I say that? Let's just talk about that real quick. And then I really want to ask you guys, why did we get the victory on this? Because it does look like a victory for one side over the other. But in the meantime, can I just say, has the left all of a sudden rediscovered that women are different than men in the last few days? Have you noticed this full-throated defense of womanhood?
Yeah. And I have not. I actually saw a very strange thing NPR did where they had a fact check, and one of the fact checks was that only women get abortions. And they said, no, actually, some men do. And
actually, no, NPR, that's not true.
That was not even their most outrageous lie or misrepresentation under the guise of a fact check.
Can I share?
But it was stunning.
On Tuesday, Nathaniel, my youngest, he's 18. He shot me a text. He said, "All this conversation reminds me of this abortion statistic gem: 59% of women who get abortions are mothers."
So are the other 41%.
Yeah, really, that's a fascinating statistic, Nathaniel. All right, we've got to take a break. You can hear the music. When we come back, I want you guys to answer my question. So much has gone wrong in the world. Why do we have this victory? I'll ask you that question when we come back right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com. Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Hi, this is Janet Benkovic-Williams. There's nothing like Women of Grace to explain the truth of our faith Monday at 11 a.m. Eastern here on EWTN Radio. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Been pro-life since I was a child because my mother was wildly pro-life, as was my father, but my mother was more vocal about it. So you'll forgive me for being enthusiastic about the fact that the thing that so many of us have been fighting for, and I have to say, I was a terrible pro-life person for most of it. I was cowardly and unhelpful, but I think now that it's been overturned, I'm going to be much better as a pro-life person. I think I'm going to get really good at it now. So I'm not taking any credit for it. I was the least among these. But the thing we prayed and hoped for, that moment seems to be upon us. And so I think it's okay to take all the time we're taking to talk about this particular news story. But this it's not a panel just devoted to the Roe versus Wade discussion. We have other news stories that we will get to. But I want to ask the two of you, I think you share my joy at the news that we are about to be free of these ridiculous decisions, Roe and Casey. You share that, both of you? Is that fair enough to say?
I would say it looks hopeful. The odds are better than 50%, but there have been so many Charlie Brown football moments on this issue.
I know what you
that
mean.
I can't just like sleep soundly knowing that there won't be some awful like 3-2-4 decision where Kavanaugh and Roberts preserve the letter of Roe while hollowing it out even further.
I think the bigger concern is just for the long term. Like I said earlier,
all the indicators look rough for our civilization.
It's true. Yeah. This is a little bit of victory,
a bear market rally
in the long defeat, as Tolkien put it.
Yeah. Okay, so why the victory then? Either of you have a theory about that? Why the victory?
Yeah, I've got a few theories, but you can go first, Chris.
This is probably obvious. I think that most people are beginning to just reflect on the reality that a baby is a baby.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's...
Well, that reflection is probably helped by technology. It's weird.
Sure.
I think that those 3D or 4D ultrasounds that they have now...
Absolutely.
Actually help people, because people will, you know, send out a picture of their baby in the womb. That's a weird world where we're celebrating this baby in the womb, but if they wanted, they could kill it. You know, that's a weird world.
I'll never forget the Academy Awards. Who's the actress? Annette, what's her name? She I'll think of it in a second. Annette Bening. She's pregnant at the Academy Awards, and everyone is just she's obviously pregnant. Everyone's excited about. They're all making jokes about this baby that's coming. Of course, everybody in the room is a rabid so-called pro-choicer.
Yeah.
And the film that gets Best Picture or something is, I think, Cider House Rules or something like that.
That's the society we live in.
Yeah,
we're utterly schizophrenic. We absolutely love the nurses who devote their lives to caring for preemie babies. But if you want, you can kill a preemie baby. So it's a weird... Joe, go ahead. We kept you out of
this. I just want to... Let's dig into that a little bit, because I think it exposes something really incoherent. And it's wrapped up in the ideology of choice as such. Like, when choice becomes the highest good, choice is never... Like, the point of choice is always a means and not an end. The point of choosing is to choose a good thing. You know, Chesterton famously says that an open mind is there for the same reason as an open mouth, to settle on something.
Yeah, to shut it on something, yes.
Yeah, which is, Chesterton is an expert on that.
Joe.
Yeah, it's the same. But the idea is really simple. Like, you can't look at a child who's 20 weeks along and say, well, that's a baby if you want it to be, and not if you don't want it to be,
right,
for very long, because that's just, it's not serious.
Yeah.
And it has to give way. Now, I think it's worth saying, back in the 70s, people were legitimately confused about embryology. Lay people were. You know, you have that, I believe it was Life magazine, had that famous
the pictures.
Cover story, mm-hmm. you know, of an embryo on the cover. And that was really shocking and revolutionary for people. Today, it doesn't have that kind of cachet, because we've seen a million posted, like, sonograms on Facebook, or, you know, you've seen them on people's refrigerators. And so at a certain point, like you said, like the embryology is there, and people are moved by those kind of face-to-face encounters. In the same way that if there's an unjust war, the way you turn the tide against that is by doing a lot of coverage where suddenly you see the victims up close.
Right.
You know, you see, like, innocent villagers being covered in napalm, and now you don't want to be part of that anymore.
Yeah.
Nothing changed. You may have known on one level that kind of thing was happening, but now you're forced face to face with that reality. And so, that I think is the biggest single mover, is pro-lifers not giving up the fight, but really continue to press into this and say, no, this isn't just a fight about some abstract idea of personhood. These are real people whose lives are being snuffed out at a very young age. And we can't simultaneously celebrate new babies and celebrate killing new babies. Coherence doesn't last.
Can you give me the Joe Biden audio?
It's remarkable that Biden is still talking as if he were in the 70s.
The thing about this is, I think it gets to just what you're both saying, though, about this incongruity. Because one of the things that the pro... abortion side or pro-choice, I don't want to call yourself whatever you want, has to do is constantly police language. Because if you just use language the way we normally use language, then you can't be for abortion. And so this is Joe Biden. I have to say, I don't really want to do politics, but this is not the way a Catholic man should speak about children. And I'm just saying it as a Catholic man. I don't think any man should, but certainly as our brother Catholic, if someone should say, this is not acceptable to speak this way. Here, go ahead and play the clip.
So the idea that we're going to make a judgment that is going to say that no one can make the judgment to choose to abort a child based on decision by the Supreme Court, I think goes way overboard.
The jet was in the background, but he said no one should be prevented from making the choice to abort a child. Well, you're not supposed to say child. Everybody knows what it is, but you're not supposed to say child. And if you do say child, then your argument is completely gone. Like the argument then is, what are you saying, President Biden? Are you saying that we can kill children? Like, what? So it's like the old Michael Kinsey's definition of a political gaffe, when you accidentally say the truth. And yes. And that's what this is. This is a gaffe because he accidentally said the truth.
Archbishop Sample, our good friend, called him out.
Oh, did he?
Yeah, on Twitter. He said, okay, well, you, President Biden, you just said it's a child. So how does this comport with your Catholic faith?
Right. And so I think people do know that it's a child. I want to add one more thing, because I'm very proud of all the pro-life people, and I've known a lot of really courageous pro-life people. That's how I know I'm not one of them, because I've known really courageous pro-life people. And God bless them. There's certainly an element of spiritual battle that has been done here, that has been part of this, that we'll only know about when we leave this world. But I think there's also something to be said for the fact that the pro-abortion side, the side that wanted to keep abortion legal, overplayed their hand.
Yes.
They should not have, you know, like Bill Clinton should not have twice vetoed a bill that would end infanticide. You know, the killing of a baby in the process of being born. That's what these late-term abortions were. Everybody knows what that is. Everybody knows that when you end up with a dead full-term baby, what that is. They should have at some point conceded. And so the New York Times ends up this week with a headline, which is ridiculous. It says, America is clamping down on abortion rights just when Europe is opening up. And one of their examples was France, which moved its the date that you can terminate a pregnancy on from 12 weeks to 14 weeks. Well, if we had gone with it, I just, all of you who are pro-choice, I hope you will realize this. If you had said 14 weeks, we would have lost. It's because you insisted on murdering
dilation
babies.
Dilation and extraction. Yeah.
That's why you lost.
Yeah.
I had an incident once at Georgetown where I overheard two law students talking about this issue, and they were talking about partial birth abortion. And they were both pro-choice, and they both seemed to be uneasy with partial birth abortion. One of them said, yeah, but if we don't defend that, where's the line?
Yeah. Well, you should have drawn the line somewhere else.
Wow. Yeah, but
that's a coherent position, Joe.
They're right about that.
Yeah.
But right. We certainly would have gone another 50 years, I think, if they had just not been rabid.
Push a little further and say, part of the issue here, as Ruth Bader Ginsburg pointed out, is that the court really shouldn't have been the one doing this.
No,
she said society was going in a pro-reform direction. I mean, the incredible thing about this is, you can imagine three different positions. Number one is the person who says, I think abortion should be legal. Number two is the person who says, I think abortion should be enshrined in the Constitution as a right. And number three is the person who says abortion actually is enshrined in the Constitution as a right, even though it was illegal when the Constitution was written and three quarters of states had laws explicitly outlawing abortion when the 14th Amendment was passed. But they actually meant to legalize abortion. The court went with option three then.
Yeah.
Now, there are plenty of sane people in the first camp and even in the second camp. We profoundly disagree. But I think it's utterly disingenuous to say that the third thing, oh yeah, the framers really meant to protect abortion. It is just so on face ludicrous.
Yeah.
And given that, you know, people are saying, oh, the court is acting in such a, you know, legislative, they're acting like a super legislature here by striking down Roe. And it's like, no. If the court said all abortions everywhere are illegal, then you could make that argument. All they're saying is, we really shouldn't have gotten involved in this debate to begin with.
Well,
we should really step out now.
I actually have heard people say, how can we let five unelected judges make this decision? Well, who do you think made the Roe decision?
Seven unelected judges.
Yeah, right. And I heard one senator, the senator from Massachusetts, Elizabeth Warren. She said,
oh, she lost her mind.
She said on CNN, Well, now we need to get rid of the filibuster because the filibuster is not even in the Constitution. And if you're a good reporter,
for that to happen,
you would have said to her,
"If you want to see, like,
guess what else is not in the Constitution? Guess what else? Just pick something that's in the news right now is not in the Constitution. Yeah. What do you think it might be? All right, I want to. When we come back, I want to ask you about how the media did with this, and then we'll stop talking about Roe for now because we really don't know what's going to happen. Although I'm more optimistic than Joe is,
Can I give you a quick stat from one of the footnotes in the draft decision? They point out something that I think is people don't know. When we talk about this Europe-U.S. comparison, like you mentioned before, only 600 countries have laws on abortion as extreme as ours: Canada, China, the Netherlands, North Korea, Singapore, and Vietnam.
Yeah. Yeah. And what was the last one?
It's Vietnam. Yeah. It's basically Canada
communists and us
and crazy communists.
Yeah. Wait, what's the Canada and crazy communists? That's just a joke, Canada. I'm only joking. We'll be right back after this.
This is Archbishop Paul Coakley, the Archdiocese of Oklahoma City, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Do you love praying for people? Have you ever wanted to use your gift of prayer to share Jesus with others and build up the body of Christ? Start a public prayer station with St. Paul Street Evangelization. Listen to people's needs, pray with them, or invite them to meet you at church. St. Paul Street Evangelization can help you get started. Find out how at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
I'm quite sure I've heard over 1,000 conversion stories. And when you hear this, you have this opportunity of asking the question, oh, like, Lord, what was it that opened this person's heart to you? What did you use?
The Journey Home with Marcus Grodi, Monday night, 8 Eastern, on EWTN Radio and Television.
I am going to let some callers in here. I'm sorry, callers, that I've kept you out. But I wanted to make a quick observation to the two of you and see what you think about this. I actually don't think that this Roe versus Wade decision is going to be the earthquake that many people think it's going to be. I think it's going to settle in quickly, and people are going to get used to it, and we'll go on from there. I don't think that the pro-abortion side has the staying power that the pro-life side has, because they're fighting the truth. They don't have the truth on their side. And so, and here's my evidence for it. I just want to share some evidence for it. Monday night, I'm, you know, I see this, you know, come through on my phone that this decision has been, you know, published by Politico. So I turn on the TV, absolute, every hour, because I can't sleep, I got to watch the news every hour now, you know. So every hour is starting with outrage and ending with outrage. And there's just apocalyptic talk. And, you know, Jeffrey Toobin, the first guy they put on CNN. And no, you will not make any jokes about Jeffrey Toobin. He's a fine man.
I didn't need to.
Stop it.
Still have his job?
No, just stop. We're not talking about that. But, you know, apocalyptic predictions from Jeff. Why did I say Jeffrey Toobin's name? But, you know, he's their legal guy, and he's just, this is this, and this is that. And, okay, so fine. I'm a little nervous. I'm thinking, oh, society is just, we're in our death throes now. This is going to be rioting in the streets again, and maybe it will be. But this is Roe versus Wade being overturned. This is a civilizational redirection in many ways, certainly legally, in the legal field. So I turned on, last night I thought, I'm going to watch the news. And I recorded all the news shows, CNN, MSNBC, Democracy Now. You know what I'm talking about, Democracy Now? That ABC News, PBS News. Do you know which one of them led with Roe versus Wade? None of them. It wasn't the first story. On CNN, it was the fourth story. On PBS, they did 40 minutes of reporting on other stories before they mentioned this. This is 2 days after. There's no way that this is by the fall we'll have settled in, and this will be accepted by the American people. I'm convinced of it now.
It will not be.
I certainly I hope you're right. And I think one thing, again, remember the thing I said about how the court isn't outlawing abortion across the country. Americans don't really understand what Roe v. Wade means or right. what overturning it means. But the idea that, you know, 22 states will probably pass some pretty extreme restrictions. You'll get some more moderate restrictions in some other states. And then you'll get laws doubling down on abortion in some of the other states. And so people are going to get laws that more closely reflect the beliefs of their state and their society. And that may be better or worse than the public as a whole. You know, that's the thing about an average. You know, half the people are below it. But people aren't going to have as much room to be outraged that, you know, Arkansas votes like Arkansas or that California votes like California. That's unfortunate, maybe, to the people on the losing end of the stick there. But passing a federal law to impose blue state principles on red states is insane. It's bad politics.
What will happen in Kansas?
Kansas is actually tougher than it seems, because we have right now a Democratic pro-choice governor who is up for re-election. We have a court that's really bad, and there is a draft constitutional amendment called the Value Them Both Amendment that's seeking to overturn a recent Kansas Supreme Court decision that claimed to have found, miraculously, a right to abortion in the Kansas Constitution, which is really
That's where they're keeping it. They're keeping it in the Kansas. Yeah, well, I'll tell you what, whatever happens in Kansas, it's going to be worse in California. So I think that
this is something that is important to point out. The fact that it's going back to the states, which is where this debate belongs in our federal arrangement, is very, very good news. Probably never for California. Probably never.
But I'll tell you at a certain point.
But in Kansas, I think
they'll get there.
At the state level, there is genuine hope of debate and people coming to their senses.
But even Governor Gavin Newsom, the governor of our state.
Our Catholic governor.
Said, we're going to have abortion all 9 months protected in every circumstance. That, I'm sorry, but that's a mistake. They're not going to win that.
So eventually, if a woman is in labor and then she decides she wants to,
right. They have not learned the lesson.
No.
They're going to overplay their hand everywhere that they can. And
19% of Americans agree with that view.
Yeah, yeah.
And even then, probably a good chunk of them only are saying that because they don't really want to draw the line and would actually be uncomfortable defending that principle if you really press them on a partial birth abortion ban.
It's going to be pretty hard to hold a whole state to the idea that we should be killing babies up to the minute before they're born. I just don't think they're going to be able to do it. So I don't think they have learned the lesson. I do want to go to a – you guys mind me taking a call?
Go for it.
Please.
All right. Well, let's go to Walt in Pennsylvania, listening on the TuneIn app. Walt, thanks for joining us. Go ahead with your comment for the flannel panel.
Well, it's an interesting conversation you all are having. I've been involved in the pro-life movement since 1985.
Well, congratulations on your victory, Walt.
Thank you, Walt.
Well, yes. It's a partial victory because it turns it back to the states and we'll have like slave states and free states kind of thing. It's really unworkable. But, you know, it's a first step in the right direction. But, you know, there'll still be millions of kids being killed. They'll just be in different hubs. So, that's a good thing that Roe v. Wade may be overturned. But we got a long way to go. We have to keep stigmatizing abortion. It's an evil. We have to make sure people know it's an evil. It's not just some kind of a abstract choice or, you know, and
no.
The whole idea that the baby is less important than the mother, we have to stop that nonsense. Both of them are important. We have to save both of them in situations where that's necessary. Nobody should be directly killed. That stuff we should continually point out.
Yes, I agree with you.
Or it becomes an abstraction.
Right, but
Actually, let me say something on that. I think this is something that we don't notice very much in terms of culture war or social issues. The more socially conservative side has lost almost everything in the last 30, 40, 50 years. Fights like gay marriage, you know, all of that stuff have just been a total collapse in terms of popular opinion. And a lot of it has been because frequently it comes down to the more conservative side is defending an abstract principle, like the dignity of marriage as such, while the side promoting change has some really powerful anecdotal stories. You know, look at this
about
couple.
Rights.
It's
about
so
rights.
Sad. Yeah. Right, right. And it's poorly defined, but it tugs at the heartstrings, and understandably, it changes a lot of people. But with abortion, we haven't seen that collapse. We just haven't seen the pro-life movement lose a lot of ground. They've held steady in the face of a society that's become dramatically more social liberal on everything else, and it's because they know how to do that, how to tell the story of, like, look, this isn't just an abstract idea. There's a person here.
You know where else that the sexual revolution is going to be turned back? Transgenderism. Because there are stories of regret.
Yes.
And there's going to be more stories of regret. That's another place where they've pushed too far. I'm convinced of it. And with a lack of humility to say, look at all these gains. Maybe the society needs a breather before we, start injecting children with hormones and doing surgery on minors and all. The inability to stop this obsessive necessity of constantly finding a new victim group and then creating whole new victim groups. I think they've gone too far on that. I want to play, Walt, thanks very much. We play the Don Lemon audio. It was very hard to pick out a good representative of the quality of reporting, but a good representative of the quality of American reporting is usually Don Lemon on CNN. So here's what Don had to say about abortion.
There are other issues that are beyond Christianity, where people find sacred, right? And should that, if people wanted to espouse their religious beliefs or put their religious beliefs on the courts or make them legal, Alice, would you be okay with that? There are many religions that don't like meat. Should we ban meat in the United States? I know it's just an example. I know it's not equal, but how far do we take this? Supposed to be a separation of church and state. And I understand that. I understand your feelings about it, and I accept that. I understand, Kirsten, your feelings about it, and I accept that. But shouldn't there be a separation of church and state? And when you have something like this, shouldn't it be based on what the doctor and the woman thinks is okay rather than on a religious belief? Because part of the reason, a main part of the reason this country was founded is for religious freedom.
I'm going to go with, I agree with Don Lemon. We should just base this on science and commonly held morality and not even bring religion into it.
How about
just what does science say about when life begins, and what does commonly held morality say about how you're supposed to treat human life? I'm with Don Lemon, 100%. I didn't know he was pro-life, but I am totally with him on this.
It's incredible to me that, like, pro-lifers would be like, look at all this embryology, look at all this science about when life begins. And at the end of it, pro-choicers are just like, so you're saying you want to impose Leviticus on all of
us? Yeah, right. Like, I didn't
just
say
like
anything
the hand religious. Tale.
Exactly.
And it's like, I don't see pro-life. Like, go read the opinion and see where does he quote the Bible. In fact, he makes fun of Roe v. Wade for having this long discourse about, like, what was the ancient view in different religions on abortion, because it doesn't matter legally.
It's not a religious question.
Totally irrelevant.
Yeah.
And so, you know, like, the only side bringing religion into this that I'm seeing are pro-choicers trying to strawman the pro-life view as us just trying to impose the Bible.
Well, I don't know. I felt like Don was advocating that we should listen to science and common sense morality. And if science says a baby's life begins at conception and common sense morality
Dear
says—
Dear science, when does life begin? Yeah. How many genders are there?
Right. Dear science, science writes back, Dear Joe, thank you for writing. Life begins at conception. Or fertilization,
why
or whatever
it's
word you
conception.
Want.
Yeah.
But and then we'll, you know, then we'll treat that child like a human being is supposed to be treated. I applaud Don Lemon. You have anything to say about how the media handled this?
They handled it with their particular incoherence, and this is a great example of it. Yeah. They do not agree on the fundamental points of departure for the discussion to take place. In this case, in particular, I think we use an expression called natural law, you know, quite apart from the Decalogue or the Catechism of the Catholic Church. And it's opposed to the natural law to murder someone, to take an innocent life. I think, by the way, this is one reason this particular issue, and we do use the language of civil rights in the pro-life movement, which I'm sort of unenthusiastic about. I prefer the language of natural law, but we do use that language. And so that language of civil rights works, I think, very much when people are talking about, you know, the right to marry my boyfriend, something like that. But in a case such as this, where you're taking a life, it's so obviously opposed to the natural law, and people know it.
I'd like to thank two people for the overturning of Roe v. Wade, who I'm sure helped in that effort. Mary, whose month this was announced in.
Amen.
And her son, Jesus. And now it's their victory, and maybe we can be a small part of it as it continues, hopefully. We'll stop talking about Roe versus Wade, and we'll get into transgenderism and war and Twitter and all kinds of other stuff in the second hour as the flannel panel continues on Catholic Answers Live. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host, wearing my flannel shirt because it's the flannel panel. Friday panel with Chris Check, our president, and Joe Heschmeyer, the junior apologist here at Catholic. I've never called you that before, but you are the newest.
You haven't.
You're the newest apologist here, so you're the junior apologist.
I think if memory serves, I'm 2 months younger than Trent as well, so I'm the junior apologist in a couple of ways.
Oh, you're younger than Trent by 2 months?
Nobody's younger than Trent. Is there?
No, I think Trent's 11. Was born in... Yeah, I know. He carries it differently. I've lived a more ragged life. But I think he was born in January 85. I'm born in March.
Oh. So I was only a junior in college.
I was in college.
All right. If you want to get in the conversation, it's 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. I told you we're going to talk about all new stuff. I do want to talk about real quick, I think how should I put this? Maybe as a public service announcement, be careful at a Catholic church this weekend. Did you know that there's some groups online calling for protesting at Catholic churches?
Not protesting, disrupting.
Oh, they're doing the
disrupting mass on Mother's Day.
By the way, this
speaks exactly to what we were talking about in the previous hour of overplaying the hand. Yeah. Let's see if we can win hearts and minds over to our side by walking into people's places of worship and causing a scene and vandalizing. By the way, our good friends Chuck Lemandry and Paul Giona, special counsel at the Thomas More Society, have sent a scathing letter of warning to this group Ruth sent us.
Yeah. Oh, Ruth sent us. Yeah.
Ruth sent us.
But Rise Up for Abortion is another group that I saw is doing it.
So, letting them know that in fact what they're doing could well be prosecuted as a hate crime.
This is what they tweeted out. But they've organized all kinds of protests. But whether you're a Catholic for choice, ex-Catholic, or other of no faith, recognize that six extremist Catholics set out to overturn Roe. Stand at or in a local Catholic church Sunday, May 8th. Hashtag war on woman. Hashtag Mother's Day strike. So
we are calling for...
I like that they were actually aware that they were doing this on Mother's Day. They're like, we want to be as obnoxious as possible and alienate the very people we would need to get their political
support.
Doesn't
that seem slightly demonic, though, to think, you know what we'll do? On the day that the country is celebrating mothers and motherhood,
let's celebrate killing babies.
We'll go to churches and celebrate to defend the right to kill children. Yeah. It seems like
we are calling for interrupting mass or picketing churches nationwide.
Are we the baddies
on Mother's Day? Well, you know, this reminds me of the penultimate scene there in the first Lewis book, where they're dragging the lion up onto the tablet to kill him there.
Yeah,
they're completely losing their minds.
A kind of Dionysian moment.
They're totally losing their minds.
Yeah, it's so if I see anybody dressed as a handmaid coming into church. I'm gonna
make
spot
sure it's
you.
Not a religious order you haven't seen before.
I know who you are if you're wearing that handmaid outfit. So I mean, I don't know what to say. I mean, unless
is the most dangerous weekend to start veiling.
Don't do it this weekend. I don't know what else to say about this. It's pathetic. It's I remember that during the AIDS crisis, there was a lot of
ACT UP in New York.
Yeah, ACT UP doing these nasty things. I saw it at the cathedral in Boston. It was ugly.
Ratzinger, when he was Ratzinger, was giving a communion and at St. Patrick's, and he was. They came up and started shouting at him.
Yeah,
and,
right.
Or on other occasions they would like throw condoms or fling blood at people.
Yeah, I remember them throwing
that wins hearts and minds. That kind of behavior.
Yeah. I remember walking out of the cathedral in Boston in those days when they were throwing condoms at people and. Actually, kind of feeling kind of proud to be Catholic. I don't think that's what they meant to do, but there's little children and stuff. It's upsetting to them, but if you're just a normal person, you know.
I feel like I'm Tim Staples here. I'm going to quote scripture. Our Lord says, they will hate you because of me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So maybe some of them, it'll be good for them to be in church again. Okay. But so look out for those handmade outfits. But it's strange because Justice Sotomayor.
Can I add something real quick?
Yeah,
it's a terrible book. That book is incoherent.
The Handmaid's Tale?
Like the worst. It's the worst dystopia.
I can't believe you actually took the time to make your way through it.
Back in college, I may have dated a girl who was really into the book. Look, we've all had our dark moments in the past. It's so dumb. It's even as a TV show, it's like, this is too dumb to watch. The idea that like Protestants are going to take over the country and create a dystopia where one woman is like the wife, but they use another woman as the surrogate mother. And the ironic part is like, we're actually doing that in this society, and it's being cheered by the people wearing the handmaid costumes.
Yeah, it's,
like,
it's the gay couples that are doing it. Yeah.
Yes,
right.
I know.
That are turning
the actual dystopia. Margaret Atwood was talking about, you've cheered it, but then you're going and like decrying that federal law doesn't allow you to kill your baby.
That's a very good point, Joe.
It's imbecilic.
But the other thing is, I always love the tactic of they make this Handmaid's TV show and they give it all kinds of awards and everything. They everybody pat each other on the back and all that. And then you object to it. You know, we do a video here or something saying, this is really just anti-Christian bigotry. And they'll go, it's just a TV show. Why are you bothering about it? And then they all dress up as handmaids and come to church, you know, to upset. Well, I thought it was just a TV show. What happened here?
I was utterly unaware of this phenomenon, by the way. People actually dress up as characters from this movie and
it's a TV show.
Oh, I'm blanking on her, not Elizabeth Olsen.
But you dress as a character from the TV show, and
women are forced to wear this kind of hilarious.
Oh, I see. Okay, right.
Outfit.
Right.
Is it?
Yeah, because if there's one group that's controlling women's clothing, it's clearly evangelicals. I mean. What the heck?
Which group is it, Cy?
I don't know.
About fashion designers? They've done more physical damage to women.
I know. Yeah, right.
But like, it's like things that you were worried about in the 80s happening when the moral majority seemed poised to dominate American politics for 40 years. And then it's like, I don't know, none of that happened. None of that came true. The moral majority is probably a minority now.
Right.
It seems like the wrong time to start brewing all of this, like, kind of the left version of McCarthyism, these dystopias right around the corner.
I feel like there's something in me that is familiar with what they're doing. That in my life, when I have done evil.
Are you talking about Halloween?
I'm talking about actual doing evil. That when I have done evil, and I have done evil in my life, and I hope you all never find out about it. But there's a certain way in which you work yourself up to it by giving yourself moral permission, by kind of claiming a victimhood or claiming that this is the way we give ourselves more. When we want to really scream at our spouse, you know, we first review in our head all of the offenses that our spouse has committed. And then we imagine things that she'll say in the future, and so that we can kind of gin up this moral permission. And I think these kind of victim porn shows, like Handmaid's Tales, are a way of generating a permission to behave in a way that really people should not behave that way. Stop it. But I don't think I'm better than these people. I think that I can speak from my own experience and say, when you're doing that, when you're ginning yourself up to give yourself moral permission to do what you know is wrong, you shouldn't be disrupting people's church services, then stop. Maybe say a little prayer. Regroup. Amen. Don't do that.
Can we take Tom?
It speaks to something. Oh, go ahead.
He's got an interesting point here.
Oh, you want to go to Tom Nebraska?
Yeah.
There was one church that was vandalized, by the way, in this. You can read about it. Just look it up online. But right now I will go. Wait. Tom in Omaha's not there. He's not on the line.
Did we lose him?
Yeah.
He made an interesting point here.
The pro-life movement is mostly Catholic, Tom was going to tell us. But those states that have the least Catholics are the most pro-life. Which is most interesting, says Tom, and I think that is right, and there's a good reason for that. But
I think it speaks to the point that Joe made in the first hour, that the Catholic Church helped restrain Protestantism from where it was going, from its natural end.
A recent article, March. Christianity Today article written by, I assume, a Protestant named Megan Fowler, called "Why Haven't There Been Any Evangelicals on the Supreme Court?" And her point is there's never been anyone who was non-denominational or evangelical until just now with Ketanji Brown Jackson. that she's the and she's not, you know, a typical non-denominational or evangelical in terms of her voting or anything like that, but that's the closest you get. There was actually an incredibly long stretch from 2018 to 2017, excuse me, from 2008 to 2017, where there were no Protestants on the court at all. It was just Catholics and Jews.
Yeah, but
and that's weird.
Yeah, it's weird, but I hate to say this, but it's actually true. There did develop in the 1970s and 80s a kind of anti-intellectualism among many evangelicals, and I think they wrote about it. I'm not making this up. They wrote the books about it.
The crisis of the evangelical mind.
Right, and they,
and she makes that point, but she also makes the argument that Catholics typically do a better job of presenting morals in terms of natural law rather than quoting scripture. And it's much easier as a non-believer to wave away scripture, which is why pro-choice people wanted to say, oh, you know, the Don Lemon quote from the last hour. Oh, you're just imposing the Bible on us. It's like, no. Natural law is the thing. Like, you know, yeah. Murder's wrong. You can't not know that.
Right.
So then the question becomes, is this murder or not? And it turns out it is.
Yeah, right. But well said, Joe. But also there's the other side of it that I would like to address on Tom's question, which is think of very, very Catholic states like Massachusetts, yeah. New York, Illinois. These are also states in which the practice of Catholicism is at a kind of Ireland or Quebec level. You know, that there's a nominal Catholicism there, but you never...
I think Ireland's better, yeah.
You don't really have nominal evangelicals, you know? Like, I'm evangelical because my family was evangelical. It's either I am or I'm not. But with Catholics, yeah, my family's been Catholic for 8 generations and I got baptized. So there's a lot... The Catholic Church, less than half of Catholics go to Sunday Mass. Fewer than half of Catholics go to Sunday Mass. So there's Catholicism, you just can't get out of it that easily. And so you end up with high Catholic populations that in practice are not really living the Catholic faith.
I think, Joe, you're mistaken. I would say Massachusetts is more culturally Catholic than Ireland.
Wow.
For everything that the Irish that we talk to tell us, I have not been there. I don't know. That it's really a wreck. Well, it's something like Quebec.
I've been to Ireland 60s. Like 5 times.
Look at the number.
I mean, I'm biased, though. I like stayed with priests and stuff. So
yeah, they're still Catholic, Joe.
Right. Well,
if you're staying in rectories, Joe, they're still yeah. Catholic. Okay.
So you don't have. That's fair. I probably have a skewed sample.
No, I don't know, but
I've seen some amazing Irish Catholics.
I'm sure that's the case.
Voted for the pro-choice amendment. And it wasn't a very close fight.
But there are wonderful French-Canadian Catholics, too, but French Canada is not very Catholic.
No.
You know,
okay, let's sketch out a theory of why that might be. So in the 1940s, French-Canadians were closely allied, church and state, with a fairly far-right government that then fell out of power with, like, there was a big social movement in the early 60s that really pushed Quebec a lot leftward. And that alliance really backfired in a lot of ways. So that's one way the church kind of loses clout and power,
yeah.
Getting too close to the power that be, and then the political power falls out of
favor. There's a clericalism.
Yeah, I was going to say, don't deny the clericalism.
In the Quebec story
there
as well.
There was a sick Catholicism in French Canada
yeah.
that was very clerical.
But I think the other way is you become too close to the politics and the politicians change on
yeah,
you.
Right. Yeah,
not that they fall out of favor, but that they, right. Yeah. they start, you know, so... In Boston, they had, you know, Democratic fundraisers in churches or like, in, you know, church
sure.
basements and the like.
Yeah.
And so the connection, you know, go back to 1876 in the U.S. The Democratic Party is decried as the party of rum rebellion and Romanism because it was the anti-prohibition, the pro-Southern and pro-Catholic party. And
let's
that's what the Republicans
bring that back.
Ran.
Let's bring that rum yeah. and Roman.
I would love rum a Romanism. Rum rebellion Romanism yeah. Yeah. platform.
I don't know about rebellion. But, I'm not really into all
well,
that.
Well, yeah, not the Confederacy, but a rebellion in general.
We got to take a break. I'm sorry, Joe. Yeah. Right in the middle of your point. We got to take a break. We'll be right back. And we're moving on from... seriously, we're moving on from Roe versus Wade now. I got other things to talk about. Right back with more of the Flannel Panel talking about the news of the world from a Catholic perspective right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast. Available online at Catholic.com.
Underwriting support provided by Homeschool Connections. Homeschool Connections hosts the Catholic Homeschool Conference. The 2022 Catholic Homeschool Conference is June 10th through 11th, and the website is CatholicHomeschoolConference.com. That's CatholicHomeschoolConference.com.
Underwriting by Great Catholic Music.
Great Catholic Music, your one-of-a-kind streaming platform for traditional Catholic hymns and contemporary favorites 24 hours a day. Music that soothes the soul, that's safe for the whole family to listen to. What a relief. Great Catholic Music. Download the free mobile app or listen on any Alexa-enabled device or write from your PC or tablet at greatcatholicmusic.com. Great Catholic Music, melodies for the soul.
This is Cecilia Flannery, director of Divine Mercy Radio. The world needs Catholic radio because it changes lives and saves souls for Jesus. It brings each of us closer to Him. And when you're closer to Jesus, there's a very good chance you will spend eternity with Him. Catholic radio not only changes your life in this world, it changes it for all of eternity.
The world needs EWTN Catholic Radio, now more than ever.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We call it the flannel panel because we all wear flannel shirts on Fridays and we talk about the news from a Catholic perspective. If you want to vote on the best flannel shirt of this week's episode, just go to YouTube where you can watch the show or Facebook.
I'm going to come from behind.
Are you going to come from? Because you're really behind right now. Here's the deal. My shirt currently has 63% of the votes. Joe's shirt has 23% of the votes. And Chris's shirt, 15% of the votes.
So we actually check the IP addresses of the people who are participating in this, and it happens they're all at 2020 Gillespie Way.
Yeah, so it's, right. it's our fellow employees.
Just going on right. No more days for me.
Yeah,
yeah. No more days off.
That's it. No more days off.
Forget this.
All right. I don't know if you know that HHS Assistant Secretary for Health. I hope I have that title right, is Admiral Rachel Levine, born Richard Levine, now living as a lady. How are you supposed to say this? I'm not good at this stuff. Rachel Levine, who is a beautiful child of God and to be loved and respected, but not to be trusted on issues of transgenderism because Rachel Levine has some wild ideas about that and gave a speech recently that because of the position of assistant secretary in HHS is kind of horrifying. And Joe, you sent this speech to me. I read the speech. What did you make of this?
Yeah, so the critical part is it's all about what Levine calls gender-affirming care. Gender-affirming care is medical care, it is mental health care, it is suicide prevention care, it improves quality of life, and it saves lives. That's kind of the premise Levine argues for. And gender-affirming care, for those who aren't familiar with the euphemism,
is in fact not gender-affirming.
No.
Exactly. It's actually gender-denying care. We're going to take your gender and medically quash it with puberty suppressors, cross-hormonal treatment, chest reconstructive surgery where they just, chop off body parts, and gender reaffirming genital surgeries, which also chop off body parts.
Right. We're against that.
Yes. Yeah. Well, Levine's got news for you. Those who now attack our LGBTQI+ community are driven by an agenda that has nothing to do with medicine, nothing to do with science, and nothing to do with warmth, empathy, compassion, or understanding. They're rejecting the value of supportive medicine, rejecting well-established science, and rejecting basic human compassion. They prefer slander, bigotry, and gender-baiting hate speech. Yeah. The mantle of concern for children is being claimed to destroy children's life. So if you don't agree with surgically chopping a child up because they're confused at age 12.
Because that's what this is about.
This was not about adults. This is about children and teens. Specifically, right. That's what the talk was about.
I want to distinguish between the person and the words. And with all due respect to Admiral Levine, that is demonic lying. That is deception.
Absolutely.
Of the most profound kind. I believe that I am quoting Pope Francis in saying this. And God bless Pope Francis for his clarity again and again on this issue of the transgender anti-science, anti-humanity, lying demonism. It's evil, and it's got to stop. And we have to be fearless in confronting it. But we also have to be nice to people while we do it.
Yeah, and the people being lambasted here by an elected official, by the way, as hating children and just wanting
an appointed hate speech official.
Yeah, but approved. Sorry, you're right. Appointed official, but approved by the Senate. That's the position Levine is arguing for, supported only by 29% of Americans. 44% of Americans oppose giving puberty blockers to teenagers. And that's just puberty blockers. That's not surgery. 27% of Americans aren't sure. So if you're in, you know, the 7 out of 10 Americans who aren't on board with this agenda, according to Levine, it's because you don't care about truth or medicine or compassion, but just want to see children destroyed. That's not just demonic. It is so incredibly hateful. To believe that 71% of the people around you are just monsters that need to be crushed.
Because they know that you're not a lady.
It's a very weird position to...
I'm sorry. Yes, exactly. I just don't believe in lying about this. We're supposed to pretend like the emperor is wearing beautiful robes, but I'm sorry. No, you're not a lady.
I would encourage people... I mentioned Lewis earlier. I would encourage people to read the third book in his so-called Science...
Are you getting some kind of kickback from the C.S. Lewis
people? No. And you know, actually, I have a lot of quarrels with C.S. Lewis. It's kind of funny. But the third book in his science fiction, so-called science fiction trilogy, That Hideous Strength, one of the principal characters is a man whose job it is to write sort of position papers and press releases for the NICE, the National Institute for, I don't remember, Creative Experiments or something like that. And this is exactly the kind, and he's a very intelligent man, and he's very rhetorically skilled and very good at manipulating language. This is exactly the kind of statements that he prepares, where he appeals to science, he appeals to empathy, and all to say the opposite of what in fact he is saying.
Yeah.
If you want to know,
that's a very good point. Orwell, because Lewis is really good.
He's very good at this. Yeah. Orwell is great. I love him too. Mm-hmm. But if you want to understand what is going on right now from halls of power and how they are using language, read That Hideous Strength.
Thank you. I'm really, really glad you said that. I am very much in the Pink Floyd school of thought on this. Hey, teacher, yes, leave them kids alone. Like that to me, I
if you don't eat your meat,
you're not going to get any pudding.
Yeah, I feel like the establishment needs to be challenged on this. They think that they're challenging the establishment. They're not. You're the establishment. You're in all the universities. Cooper's
is,
on your side.
This is the thing that makes this so scary. The HHS is the largest grant writing agency in the U.S. So when we talk about the science, well, to even do the science, you've got to write to Levine's office and get the money to run the studies to show that Levine is just lying about this. Good luck. Yeah. And so, you know, right now, one of the best studies supporting sanity, one of the best studies showing, no, you don't need to give trans-identifying kids surgery, comes out of Sweden. And it came out of Sweden by mistake. I don't know if you know, are you familiar with this, Brandstorm and Hachan?
You've actually told me about this, but please, go ahead.
Okay, so Sweden keeps a huge database of medical information that we wouldn't do here today. And so this study looks at 10 years of medical data for the entire population of Sweden. And so it can compare everyone who's diagnosed with gender dysphoria and look at the long-term outcomes of those who have surgery and those who don't have surgery. And the original report said, oh, wow, you know, even though surgery is scary, it turns out it's really good for transgender people. It provides better long-term benefits in terms of mental health, mood and anxiety disorder, antidepressants, anti-anxiety prescriptions, and hospitalizations after suicide attempts. All of those go down in the 10-year span that we looked at. And then it turned out, as some eagle-eyed readers noticed, they'd crunched the numbers wrong, and it actually said the opposite of all those things, that there was no benefit to any of those things. And in fact, those who'd gotten surgery seemed to fare slightly worse. Now, Levine's entire argument is based on if they don't get this surgery, they're going to kill themselves. Yeah. And there's just literally no good data to support that. And it's outrageous that anyone, let alone an HHS official should make that kind of flagrantly false scientific claim to support a political agenda that's unpopular for a reason.
And there's another basic problem here, which is that there's a massive selection bias in who chooses to be a social scientist. I mean, and social sciences departments will not accept people to be social sciences at their university unless they are toeing the line on many of these. So the
And then there's the
replication crisis. I don't believe any of these studies. I believe, you know what? There's a difference between a boy and a girl. Doctor doesn't assign you your sex at birth. Use your head, people. I don't think we need to appeal to a lot of studies and stuff. We need to say to people, is the emperor wearing clothes or not? Do you see any clothes? Because this is foolish, what is going on. This has to stop. And it, you know what? It's overreach as well. And it's when the stories of the damaged and destroyed lives of these children come out, that's when we will see who was right and who was wrong on this one. Right back with more after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you. Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Hi, this is Janet Benkovic-Williams. There's nothing like Women of Grace to explain the truth of our faith Monday at 11 a.m. Eastern here on EWTN Radio. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live, Friday flannel panel. My flannel shirt is currently winning because there's a light directly above me that's making my shirt shine on the internet, and that's why I'm winning.
Cy, where did you get that cool sticker on your laptop there?
Don't listen to Donna.
Where did you get that cool sticker? Look
at that.
I love Catholic Answers. The Sacred Heart.
At shop.catholic.com,
Chris. That is so cool.
I got it over at... What about your cool sticker of Jimmy Akin on your computer,
Chris? Oh, yeah. Shop.catholic.com.
All right, Donna. We did it.
You're
we
looking
did your little
for,
ad,
You're looking
Donna.
For cool stickers for your guitar case.
Do we get any calls on the on my...
your computer.
On my Impolitic...
Oh, I know. Those...
Transgender... No calls? Okay,
the water mugs that you carry around. It'll stick to anything. I love Catholic Answers.
Shop.catholic.com. The number is 888-318-7884 if you want to correct any of our panel members. 888-318-7884.
Just try.
If you want to vote on who's wearing the best flannel shirt, just go to our Facebook video feed or go to our YouTube video feed and vote. There's a place where you can vote on who's wearing, who's got the best flannel shirt on. 888-318-7884 if you want to get in on the conversation. I'm ready to move on from transgender stuff, but I don't want to do it if you guys are not, if there were more points you wanted to make.
Well, the only thing I would say is, you know, you ended by saying you don't really care about the studies. The reason I think there's a merit to the studies and the word of warning, I want to give her this.
Okay.
It's good to know which interventions help or hurt someone's mental health. And I would give the example of if you have someone with Alzheimer's, and people are always saying, well, should you go along with the delusions so that they aren't needlessly upset, or should you really confront them every time they come up? So I could see someone saying, I know men are men and women are women and never the twain shall meet, but I don't know how to handle my kid who doesn't. And I don't know, you know, okay. And so I get, you know, people wanting to take a scientifically informed and humanly compassionate approach. I just think it's important to stress that despite the claims of activists, it doesn't actually lead your kid to kill themselves if you tell them the truth about men and women. Yeah, the well second said. Thing I'd say is that science may change in the future because the HHS person who controls the purse strings is not exactly unbiased and has made it clear that anyone who right. takes a different view hates kids and science and reality and just wants kids to die. So that's not going to get a bunch of funding, you know, people who are saying same things.
Right. Sai, the thing that I would say is this. This Admiral Levine and those like her, they know that men and women are different. They know that sex is not assigned by the doctor or by the person's inclination. Perhaps in the case of someone who truly has a mental illness, they may have this belief. So what is the motive here? I think that we need to answer that question. And it is we want to justify our passions. Now, they're not going to express it this way.
Yeah.
They're not going to say, well, I want to fulfill or attempt to fulfill my passions however I wish. But that, in fact, is what is happening. And it's what motivates the desire to kill the baby. And it's what motivating the desire to indulge in all manner of deviant behavior. And I think that it's important for Christians, Catholics, who want to argue coherently about this, they need to understand that those with whom they're going to have this conversation are beginning from a position of trying to justify their passions.
Yeah.
That's where they're starting.
Yeah,
and that's all this is about. And they can use very clever rhetoric, or as Joe points out, millions and millions of taxpayer money. But it's to justify their disordered passions.
And you know, living within reality hurts.
Yes, it
hurts to live within the bounds of reality.
It actually hurts. But it hurts more to live. It hurts more to live outside the boundaries of reality.
You can't get away from the hurt by living in a fantasy world where you just get to be whatever you want to be. That dumb slogan from Hollywood. The fact is, it hurts to live in reality. But if you stay with reality, it's a productive hurt. You grow up, you mature, and you become what your loving Creator designed you to become. And I do think, you know, there's a certain way we talk about these things when we're on the air. But I don't want to give the impression that any person should ever be disrespected because of what they're wearing, or because of what they say their name is, or because they have a persistent ideation that they're a girl when in fact they're a boy. I am just not going to, you know, while in front of a microphone, pretend that a girl is a girl or a boy is a boy, and I'm not allowed to say that. That rule that you're not allowed to say things, that's what keeps people trapped in unreality. But I do also advocate, and I hope that I live, I'll try, you know, basic decency and also Christian charity modeled on Christ, who surrounded himself with, I mean, all kinds of wild people, and he was perfectly comfortable.
It's
difficult because the two things we're really lacking are courage and charity.
Yeah.
And the people who most are lacking the one seem to try to lean into what they imagine the other to be.
Oh, yeah.
And you know what I'm saying? Like, if you don't want to stand up to the popular culture, then you just say, well, I'm being charitable. I'm not challenging them. But if you like don't get along with those around you and you're a little more misanthropic, then you just say, look at how courageous I am, when maybe you're just a jerk.
Yeah,
you know,
I know. In my case, you're just a jerk.
Say a true thing in just kind of an unpleasant way that it doesn't actually draw people closer.
But when you see that children are physically being harmed in ways that they will never recover from, things are being stolen from them that cannot be restored to them, it does bring out a bit of the dog in you. And you want to say, that you, look, Rachel Levine, you're not the victim here. You're the bully. And you're the one.
You're not even Rachel.
You're what? Well,
you're not even Rachel here.
Anybody? Well,
yeah. No, I know. But it's a hairy one.
Well, I wouldn't have known that Rachel was Richard unless I read it before. So people's names, I don't know. Your name is yours, whatever. You know, my name is
Cy. Oh, no, it isn't whatever. She's deliberately changing her name to perpetuate a lie.
Yeah, I guess. Why are you saying she, though?
He, sorry. Well, thank you. Yeah. Well, I'm as confused as you are. So I just want to say people...
I just don't use pronouns anymore. I've given up on pronouns.
People who are mired in sin need exactly what Joe says. They need our courage and they need our charity. There's a risk of a soul being lost.
Yeah. But kindness to the person who's confused in all of this is not going to be overdone. You're not going to be too kind. You're not going to mess up and be too generous, charitable, loving, or all that kind of thing. So don't worry about that. I've had enough of this. You guys ready to move on to the next story?
Please.
Because I said before when we were talking about Roe versus Wade that there's another story in the news that we need the Catholic voice to be clear in more than we need even in Roe versus Wade. And it is this. Very serious people who are taken very seriously, are now openly talking about nuclear war. This has to stop. And we cannot have a nuclear war. We cannot do things that entice other people to use nuclear weapons. We are in such a dangerous moment, and all this bravado is sickening and disgusting to me, that we are saying things like U.S. intelligence is killing Russian generals and sinking Russian ships. What are you going to do when they respond by blowing up an army with a nuclear weapon on the battlefield? Think this through. At some point, you got to take your foot off the neck of the other guy, or he's just going to pull the plug on that grenade. And you're not wise and you're not tough because you say, just keep kicking him when he's down. He has 5,000 nuclear weapons. Are you really sure that that is the wise and prudential course that is required of Catholic people or any people of goodwill? That's where I am now. And it's very serious people. I'm talking about people who are in the think tanks and in the Congress are saying, yeah, if he lobs a nuclear weapon into Ukraine, we got to lob a nuclear weapon at him. No, stop it.
Yeah, I wish that we would be a lot clearer about that. So I think two things. One, in addition to everything you just said, there are also all sorts of unpredictable downstream consequences. When the two largest nuclear powers play that kind of saber-rattling game, the model that sends to the rest of the world, and especially smaller nuclear powers, whether it's Israel, possibly Iran, North Korea, we lose the footing to tell them they need to be responsible when we're acting in that sort of totally irresponsible sort of way. Second, there's an essay by Elizabeth Anscombe, G.E.M. Anscombe, called Modern Moral Philosophy from 1958, I think. And in it, she just points out that in her day, all the major schools of moral philosophy were consequentialist, meaning they judge the morality of an action not by the action itself, but by the consequences of the action. And that none of them could say it was always wrong to intentionally execute innocent people, because maybe that'd be good for national security. And her point was that anyone who really believes that is just showing themselves to have a corrupt mind. They're not ready to do moral philosophy. And yet these were all of the major English-speaking moral theologians and philosophers in the Western world. And so I would say the same thing. If you think it's okay to intentionally target a civilian city with a weapon to kill as many innocent people as possible, you're just not ready to have a moral conversation. And I don't care what benefit you think you get out of it, because you're not the good guy. You're a bad guy with an evil villain kind of plan. And I don't know. I don't know what else to say about it. What is worth saving in the world that is worth destroying so much of the world? I don't know how someone sanely answers that question.
Well, any police officer will tell you that de-escalation is better than shooting somebody. If there's a way to de-escalate, take the off-ramp, because you got to live with that other thing for the rest of your life, and our society has to live with it. And we're not taking the off-ramps. And I have to say, I criticize President Biden for his saying that you should be allowed to abort a child. I will say President Biden has not been saber rattling as far as nuclear weapons goes, but I wish that he would show more leadership.
I'm glad we don't nuke children. That's even worse.
Yeah, right. But I wish that, I mean, all of the American leaders would show more leadership, especially our Catholic leaders, who, as much as they're, you know, pro-choice and all that, they're still our Catholic brothers and sisters. Please, there are off-ramps. Take them. Stop this drumbeat of we're going to just keep pushing a madman until he throws a nuke at us. That's not a good strategy.
There was a period following the 30 Years' War, which was a horrible, horrible event for Europe in the 17th century, and many civilians were killed during this, what was in large part a war of religion. But it was concluded by the Peace of Westphalia, and following that time in the history of warfare, there was a genuine effort on the part of the crowns of Europe to fight what came to be called limited warfare. And this really was one of the great gifts of the 18th and into the 19th century. Now, starting with starting with the Revolution in France, the levy en masse, the mass draft, first on the revolutionary government and then under Napoleon, and then in our own country under men like Sherman. General Sherman, for example, right, which is so-called March to the Sea, I will make Georgia howl, right. We have left behind that brief and wonderful period, if you will, in the history of warfare. G.F.C. Fuller, the historian, describes this time in his excellent book on the subject. But we're in a period now of what we call total war, and a lot of this rhetoric is just so bound up in American politics right now. And if you go all the way back to the first, or particularly the second Gulf War, where you had guys like Dick Cheney and even Colin Powell talking about something called unconditional surrender. This is an immoral idea.
Yeah.
Unconditional surrender. So, and in fact, it's what it is, the same kind of bad and wicked idea that drove us to drop the bomb on innocent Japanese, right? To drive people into total submission. And I'm afraid it is entirely what informs the thinking of war fighting nowadays. And we pursue this anti-Christian evil political idea at our peril. And by the way, Sal, I would just say that your point, especially of the use even of a tactical nuke, because I know at one point there were Catholics arguing about, you know, the moral noose of nuclear weapons, and well, we're just going to use something that's going to take out a grid square, you know, a square kilometer or something like that. I'm sorry, once you bring the atom into it, as Ronald Knox wrote in his excellent book on the atom, the entire way of thinking, the entire conversation has changed.
You're not going to put that genie back in the bottle. You're never going to put that genie back in the bottle. And here's the problem. What if you push and push and push with I think much of the rhetoric is very self-righteous at the moment. You know, you get that way when there's war and a war crime is being committed and all. So for good self-righteous, reasoning, we just keep pushing and pushing and pushing until a tactical nuclear weapon is used, a small nuclear weapon, something, you know, a 10 megaton weapon, something a 10, which was smaller, kiloton weapon, just a small nuclear weapon that will only affect a very small area, won't leave. Okay, so, but then what are your choices? Now what's your off-ramp?
Right.
Because there is no off-ramp now. Now you have to say, well, all of the armies of Europe are going to march into Russia. How quickly that will happen if you don't show some prudence and care now. And one other thing, and then I'm going to take the break, Do you really want to have a peaceful century? You want a peaceful 21st century? You can't do it without Russia. At some point, you're going to have to make peace. And better do it before that nuclear weapon is used and all hell breaks loose than after. And I don't know. I'm going to leave it there and come back. I know that there are people that will want to call and talk about this, but that's fine. Call and we'll talk about it right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
There's only one. Catholic Answers Live.
Do you have a question but prefer to ask it privately? Catholic Questions can help. Go to CatholicQuestions.com to ask your question online, email us, drop us a letter, or give us a call. Longtime Catholic Answers Live apologist and author Jim Blackburn or another Catholic Questions apologist will be happy to assist you. Catholic Questions proudly supports Catholic Answers Live, so visit us at CatholicQuestions.com today. That's CatholicQuestions.com.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying, and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
You don't have to go about becoming Catholic in the most obnoxious way possible. You can aim at the least obnoxious way possible. You have to say, I love you, and I want to do everything possible to make your life pleasant and easy and wonderful. But you have to understand that if I don't follow my conscience, then I'm not going to be a good husband and father. In order for me to love you rightly, I have to love God first.
Called to Communion with Dr. David Anders. Tonight, 11 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Commenting on the news of the day from a Catholic perspective, we hope. I mean, it's our opinions. We're giving our opinions. We're not speaking as if we're the Pope or part of the Magisterium, and we're not even quoting magisterial documents. These are our opinions. Mine are very strong today.
The Catechism is a magisterial document.
Yeah, and the nuclear war thing just drives
me
crazy.
Like, the immorality of nuclear war is not really an issue on which Catholics should disagree.
No, but there, I do think there's a certain kind of prudence taught by the Lord Himself, in which if you said to Him, you know, when you've got a madman cornered, should you just keep hitting him until he, you know, throws a nuclear weapon? Or, you know, I feel like there is a, it's not that hard to know what to do as a Christian. It's hard to have the will to do it.
Can I make a commercial for you all? Did a superb focus, Joe and Cy, did a superb Catholic Answers focus a week or so ago on an hour unpacking just war. It was an excellent episode.
Thank you.
And then if somebody wants to dive deeper into the particular question of the atomic bomb, I guess ours from, I don't know, maybe 4 months ago or something.
Do we do it on in August probably anniversary of Hiroshima and Nagasaki?
Yeah, 8 months ago, whatever. Yeah. So, yeah. Two episodes on Catholic Answers Focus, well worth listening to.
Yeah, you know what? Christianity is a religion of peace. And so sometimes I feel like we talk so much about other moral issues, certainly the sexual issues, that we're like, yeah, I've got it all covered. But if you're not a person of peace, are you really a follower of Jesus Christ? Many soldiers are people of peace, but I think we need to be a little tougher on ourselves about this. Brian in Indiana, listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. We're glad you're here, Brian. Go ahead with your comment for the flannel panel.
Hey, gentlemen, I really appreciate you guys tackling this this subject. I mean, it's very rare right now that we're hearing people saying what you're saying about, you know, poking the bear. A man with four boys, two in the age range of military age, it scares the heck out of me, not just for me and my family, but for the entire world, because I do think, and as like you guys were saying, the off ramps are almost gone, and it seems like our political system right now, regardless on R or D or whatever, are pushing for this, and they are wanting some sort of escalation and a hot war on the ground with Russia, which would turn into an absolute nightmare for the world, not just for that portion of the world.
Well, I do think there's part of the decision making is we're better armed. and we have a better military than the Russians do, I don't think we would have the same enthusiasm were the tables turned on us. So the moral calculus can't be simply based on might makes right.
By the way, I don't think the difference is that significant, particularly, by the way, when it comes to
With nuclear weapons.
There's so much overkill, a billion times over.
Well, I appreciate you supporting us in,
yeah,
in
God
this.
God bless you, Brian.
I don't hear it anywhere, or very rarely do I hear it. And when you start having congressmen and the heads of, you know, the Washington think tanks openly saying, you know, Putin's going to use a nuke, and when he does, here's what we should do, and that includes us throwing nukes back or us marching across, you know, the Ural Mountains or something. What are we doing? Wake up! None of this is acceptable, and there are ways, and even the Pope has questioned America's motives in this. If you listen to him carefully, even the Pope has said, what exactly is America doing there? Are we defending Ukraine, or are we simply going to war by proxy with Russia? Now, I'm paraphrasing, but it's not moral to go to war by proxy and destroy the country that is your proxy. That's immoral. And so are we asking ourselves these questions? Joe, you look like you wanted to say something. Did you?
Yeah, I was going to tie these topics together. Specifically tie the abortion conversation in with especially the nuclear war conversation, but even to a certain extent, war by proxy. And I was going to quote Elizabeth Anscombe again, the philosopher I quoted earlier. She has, she was at Cambridge, I think, maybe Oxford. Truman was invited.
She objected to giving Truman, him an honorary degree. Right.
And she wrote a piece called Mr. Truman's Degree.
Yep.
In which she says, for men to choose to kill the innocent as a means to their ends is always murder. And murder is one of the worst of human actions. And so the reason she was pro-life was also the reason she objected to the dropping of the atomic bomb. And it really, like, it's hard to conceptualize how connected those things are. I was actually thinking about this earlier. Chris, when you were giving the example of the woman who was born in 1945 in Puerto Rico and narrowly avoided being aborted, that once you treat human life as dispensable as we did in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, as dispensable as the Nazis did in Auschwitz and a million other places, it is very hard to come back from that. And I don't think, you know, we always talk about it like, oh, well, maybe abortion will lead to the Holocaust. But in a lot of ways, I think abortion is in no small part fruit of the Holocaust and the cheapening of human life. And we need to stand up against all forms of the evil that treats the killing of the innocent as an understandable or justifiable means to avoid some difficulty or to achieve some long-term good.
Joe's point is very good, and it's one that it should be a wake-up call to all Catholics who look at American politics and try to find home in one party or the other. And there isn't any, in my mind, apart from what that guy at the National Catholic Reporter says, you know, I'm a pro-life Democrat. I don't even see, there must be four of them or something. But even if it were true, how in the world are you going to cooperate with that party? Very well. But there's war party. And there are economic injustices on both sides. And it's very, very hard for a Catholic, I think, to identify in accordance with Catholic teaching, economic, in terms of international politics, in terms of life, with either of these political parties.
Brian, I'm grateful for your call. Did you get to say everything you wanted to say?
Yeah, no, guys, but just thank you again for speaking about this portion of it, because nobody else is, and God bless you, and really appreciate it.
Well, thanks. You're very kind to say it. You know, I don't know that I certainly don't have any special insight into international politics and all. I have no particular insight. I guess I don't have another word for it, but I do know that when you're getting lazy about talking about nuclear weapons, you've crossed the line. You should start reeling yourself back in from it. Start saying, what's everything we can do to not have that happen? Like, what's everything? And stop all the, maybe it'll happen, maybe it won't. Like, what's everything we can do now? Because once we cross that, you can't come back from it. You've crossed the line that you can't come back from. I won. Joe, now, by I won, I mean I won the competition on the flannel shirts. But I can give you the score, but I'm probably not quick enough to get it before we're done. I do want to thank...
I came in distant third.
You did come in a distant third.
Yeah. I deserve it.
I think it all has to do with lighting.
But I still,
this is a real lesson in the value of lighting.
Yeah.
Because you have an awesome shirt.
Yeah,
but
nice
I voted for you.
Yeah.
Which probably makes it worse, because that means you only got five other votes.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day, everybody. Joe Heschmeyer, thank you very much. I hope
My
you'll
pleasure.
Continue to do flannel panel with us.
I'd be happy to.
Chris Check, thank you.
Always a joy, Si.
Once again, thanks to everybody who supported us in recent days. It means more than we can tell you. The gratitude and joy in this building is more than I can certainly convey via this microphone, but it's very, very real. And we'll see you next time, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.